In yesterday's video, we explored the Lucky Hole Mine. While exploring, we made a startling discovery, so if you don't want spoilers, you should probably watch that video first by clicking here. At the very bottom of the mine, behind a cultist church, down two hidden tunnels, we found a heaving, breathing, bleeding man, plant, some sort of creature. This creature is surrounded by the skeletons of six individuals. On the ground nearby is a sickle and a pile of small glass jars. What story can we make from the scene we see here? Well, we learn from the notes scattered around Lucky Hole Mine that the cultists whose bodies we presumably find lying here called this creature the Firstborn of the Wood. But this creature has another name. The Interloper. This name was given to him by a one Jeff Lane. At the very beginning of Lucky Hole Mine, we find his camp, and he left behind a holotape called The Chosen.
The Interloper is here. I can feel it clearly. Last night, in visions more real than the senses, it called to me, and I go to it now. Signs are all around that I am not the only one to hear the call, though where they have failed, I will not, for it summons me alone in the end. Before I go deeper, for the truth revealed changes all. By its very nature, let it be known, in this world, the Interloper has chosen Jeff Lane as the conduit of the unknowable. Together, the hidden reality becomes manifest at long last.
Jeff saw himself as the Chosen One, and who chose him? None other than the Interloper. He admits that he is not the only one who has been called by the Interloper. The signs all around he mentions are the other cultists here, their totems. But he says that they have failed. However, he will not. He ends by saying that the Interloper has chosen Jeff Lane as the conduit of the unknowable. But that's not where this story begins. The story begins at Point Pleasant. While exploring the ruined apartment complexes of Point Pleasant, we find Jeff Lane's former apartment. He has a Mothman poster on the wall, and a copy of The Mothman Cometh Part 2, the radio play about the Mothman, but also on his dresser, we find his holotape, Interloper.
There are other things in this world now that cannot be explained. The end of the world has awoken. Something. We all know the Mothman is out there, stalking and watching us, but what of the unseen? There are things we can only glimpse in our minds. Great entities beyond our comprehension. The Mothman is a creature more like us than the unknowable horrors in the peripheral vision of our subconscious minds. No longer just a false memory now. I have heard a tale of this entity made real, deep in the earth. And the storyteller was mad by any reckoning, but his story, no less true. My name is Jeff Lane, and I will lay bare this watcher. No matter how deep I must go, I will come to know the true nature of the Interloper.
When he recorded this holotape, he didn't see himself yet as the Chosen. He still described this occult magic as a horror. The Interloper was a watcher, and it was his job to reveal the watcher, to lay this secret bare. But by the time he gets to the Lucky Hole Mine, his motives have completely changed. He is now the Chosen One. He is now a servant of the Interloper. But he mentions the Mothman here. Why would he bring up the Mothman? Well, next to his holotape, we find a note. Wilson Brothers Garage. Jeff, you left your keys at the garage. I've got them at my house, the one up the hill from the garage, next to the door. Let yourself in to grab them if I'm not there. Don't forget to pick them up when you get your truck. Rich Wilson. Oh, and thanks for the Mothman poster. So Jeff was a fan of the Mothman, if you went and handed out Mothman posters. For the longest time, I thought the Wilson Brothers Garage was here in Point Pleasant, but it's not. The Wilson Brothers Garage is a good journey east of Point Pleasant, still in the forest, but quite a ways away. The note said that Wilson left Jeff's keys inside the house. Heading inside, we don't find them by the front door like the note said we would. Instead, if we head to the northeastern corner of the room, we find the Mothman poster that Jeff gave to Wilson, and we find Jeff's keys lying on the desk. Bathroom key. But exactly which bathroom does this key unlock? Before we find out, if we head to the basement of this house, we find a hole in a concrete wall. On the other side of the wall is another one of those strange totems, like the ones we found in Lucky Hole Mine. Wilson had a chair here, sitting right before the shrine. We find a dead mole rat with a knife stabbed in his head, lying on the ground. And at the base of the totem are more ritual bindings, like the ones we found in Lucky Hole Mine. This totem is made of tree branches, roots, and human bones. This clearly connects it to the interloper. The interloper himself was kind of part human and part plant. And if we look under the stairs here, we find a coffin. We can't interact with it, but inside Lucky Hole Mine, we found a similar coffin at the cultist church. With the bathroom key in hand, we can head back to Point Pleasant. If we go to the Mothman Museum, we find one door that I didn't explore in my video about the Mothman Museum. At the time, I didn't have a high enough lockpick to pick this lock. But Jeff's bathroom key that we found at the Wilson house fits the lock, and we can unlock it. On the other side, we see a privacy screen, which reveals a knocked down door with a sign restricted, keep out. At the top of the stairs, we see a mannequin. Heading down the stairs, we see a storeroom and a broken wall that leads to another cultist church beneath the Mothman Museum. At the rear of the church, we find three more totems, a bunch of candles arrayed, and one bottle of Radex. We find more of these totems lining the walls and a bunch of pews, just like at Lucky Hole Mine. And at the very end, we find a podium, just like the one at the mine, and on the podium, two notes. In the first, Sermon, Impending Doom. October 22nd, 2077. The all-knowing Mothman has been summoned forth. Though we were not all so lucky as to notice it, Brother Charles saw the Mothman appear out of the corner of his eye and heard whispers of impending disaster. But as quickly as he appeared, our savior was gone. The Mothman showed visions of terrible floods to occur tomorrow. The only way to survive, he says, is to find high ground or be swept away. Our brothers and sisters will be warned. Those who scoff at us and turn away from the way of the Mothman shall perish for their foolish disregard while we gather on the rooftops to praise the coming of the raging waters in the early dawn of light. This one was written on October 22nd, 2077, the day before the bombs dropped. So this Mothman's prediction of a great flood was the very date of nuclear Armageddon. In the next note, Sermon Summoning the Mothman, October 21st, 2077, the day before, we of the cult of the Mothman seek the infinite cosmic wisdom of the Mothman himself, for it is his appearance that portends disaster, and in heeding his warnings we may live, as others around us perish to their fated doom. We welcome visits from the Mothman with open arms and minds. Yes, we shall willingly summon him forth to appear to us who revere him and divulge his secrets. True believers among you, gather for this evening's. We welcome you, O Mothman. Accept our humble invitation and divert us from disaster. So on October 21st, 2 days before the bombs drop, they summon the Mothman. They may have been successful because the very next day, they describe a prophecy from the Mothman who predicted that the world would end in a flood the very next day. And what happened the very next day? The bombs dropped. It wasn't a flood of water. It was a flood of radiation. Now these totems at the southern end of this room are similar to the ones we found at Lucky Hole Mine. They're made of human skulls, large growing roots, and antlers. Antlers are an important theme. We not only find them on almost all of the shrines, both here at the Mothman Museum and at the Lucky Hole Mine, but interestingly, the rooftop of the tunnel that directly connects to the final chamber in the Lucky Hole Mine, the one where we find the interloper, is covered in antlers. The cultists had taken the pointy ends of the antlers and shoved them up into the earthen ceiling. For what reason? I don't know. Maybe it was a decoration, or maybe they wanted to keep all of that dirt in place. But all of this ties together the nature theme of these cultists. And just like at the Wilson Brother Garage, we find another small room to the east with a single solitary chair, a private throne for personal contemplation. Here we find a skill-level 3 locked box safe, and we learn some personal details of these cultists. There's a wheelchair here. We see an IV stand. Why did they need an IV? For fluids, water, or for blood? Now, here's where this gets confusing. Because though similar, at first glance, these appear to be two very different cults. Nothing at the Lucky Hole Mine talks about the Mothman. It all talks about the Firstborn of the Wood. The only thing that connects the Lucky Hole Mine cult with the Mothman here is, first, the similarity between the totems at both locations, second, the identical ritual bindings, and third, Jeff Lane. Jeff, who was a member of this Mothman cult, he had a key to the Mothman Museum bathroom that led to the secret church. He was friends with Wilson, also a member of this secret cult. The members of the cult of the Mothman saw him as a beneficent creature. The Mothman appeared to warn you of impending disaster. And despite the kookiness of this cult, their prediction came true. Ironically, their idea of going to the rooftops to avoid the floodwaters likely led to the entire Mothman cult being incinerated. They were standing on the roofs when the bombs dropped. They had absolutely no protection, not even a feeble sheetrock wall from the nuclear blast. In fact, if we explore the roofs of Point Pleasant, we don't find a single cultist corpse. We find a lot of corpses, but they're all responders or raiders. It's possible that the responders and raiders cleaned up and removed any of the cultist corpses that they found up here. Though I am disappointed that we don't find a pile of cultist skeletons in a corner somewhere. We learned that the Mothman is indeed a gentle creature. If we successfully complete the quest, The Path to Enlightenment, we can summon the Wise Mothman. He's only level 1, but he's non-hostile. He'll do a dance for us and show off a bit. We can get some screenshots. The quest and directions for how to summon the Mothman are given to us over a recording by Brother Moncrief as we approach the Landview Lighthouse.
Gather now, faithful followers of the most wise and beneficent Mothman. Let us light his holy beacon with the radiance of the fireflies. Let our beacon pierce the darkness and summon forth his divine presence that we may commune with him and partake of his wisdom.
So it's bioluminescent fluids that attract the Mothman. We find the skeleton of Brother Moncrief while exploring the Landview Lighthouse. And near to his skeleton is Brother Moncrief's note. High Priestess, I was right. The fireflies come here to mate. They go a little crazy and I got hurt pretty bad, but I was able to gather enough goo to light the lamp. Now, I just have to wait. The great Mothman will come. He has to. High Priestess? This note directly connects the cult of the Mothman with the Lucky Hole Mine. For at the church within the Lucky Hole Mine behind the podium, on top of the coffin, we find a note, His Priestess. Blessed are you, First Priestess of the Wood. Through you, we heard His voice. Through you, we gained His strength. This priestess must be the same old woman who approached the Lucky Hole Mine operator just before the end of the world. We know it was before the bombs dropped because, as we learned in the terminal at the entrance to the mine was still active when he was first approached by this old lady. He thought that she was an escapee from the nearby Allegheny Insane Asylum. A bit later, whomever operated this mine chose to shut it down, something they wouldn't have done after the bombs dropped. They wouldn't have felt the need to tell this guy to shut down the mine. They would have just abandoned it. So this guy shuts down the mine and even takes the care to place locks all over the place. Locks which this old lady, the High Priestess, and her followers broke. So before the bombs drop, we kind of have two conflicting cults here. We've got the cult of the Mothman, who are standing on the rooftops of Point Pleasant, waiting for a flood to pass by. And we've got the cult of the Mothman High Priestess, traveling all the way to the opposite end of the map to infiltrate and take over the Lucky Hole Mine. Part of this cult appears to be preoccupied with worshiping the Mothman, and part of this cult appears to be preoccupied with summoning forth this interloper, this firstborn of the wood. I believe these must be part of the same cult because they are connected not only by Jeff Lane, but also by Brother Moncrief, who was serving the very same priestess we read about at the Lucky Hole Mine. These cultists appear elsewhere in Fallout 76. Their totems are too numerous to exhaustively list in this video, but we'll talk about some of the big ones. We find a buried church just south of Raleigh Clay's bunker in the mire. This is an unmarked location, but if we sneak inside the sunken church, we find an altar surrounded by glowing fungus, wind chimes made from human bones, and another shrine. On top of the altar, we find a cultist's dagger, just like the one we found inside Lucky Hole Mine. Then, if we head back to the forest and travel south of the Billings homestead, we find the Kanawha County Cemetery. There's one large church in this cemetery, and if we head inside, we find the pews filled with skeletons, and lining the aisles, more of these Mothman totems. I think these must be the remains of pre-war citizens. If they had been killed recently by becoming scorched, their bodies would still be fresh, like the bodies of the responders and the raiders and the Brotherhood that we find scattered all over Appalachia. But these are skeletons, and we already know that the cult of the Mothman operated before the war, as we learned from the notes beneath the Mothman Museum. So we find a Mothman cult alive and healthy even before the bombs drop. Near to the podium is one of the largest shrines we find in the game, even larger than the ones in Lucky Hole Mine. And what's odd about this is that the tree or plant that the shrine is made out of appears to have grown through the wood of this podium. This totem has a Brahmin skull, but antlers like many of the others. Then if we climb the stairs behind the podium, we arrive in the attic. And in the loft, we find another shrine, and here, a human sacrifice. A human skeleton rests skewered on a pole, bending over backwards. The skeleton is still bloody. We find muscle still clinging to the bones. And behind him is another one of those giant totems. This totem is covered in human and animal skeletons, lots of antlers, and even entire human arms sticking out of it. It, like many of the smaller shrines we saw at the Lucky Hole Mine, is encircled with candles. If we climb the spiral staircase to the bell tower of the church, we find a hunting rifle, some ammunition, and a pair of pastor's vestments. I kind of get the impression that the bloodied skeleton we find impaled just below might be the skeleton of the pastor of this church. Perhaps the cultists invaded the church just before the bombs dropped, chased him to the bell tower, where he took up his gun and tried to defend himself. But they overpowered him, stripped him, and then impaled him on this pole before taking over the church. But the church in the cemetery is not the only trace we find. The cemetery is huge and has at least one mausoleum, but it also has a shack. And inside the shack, we find another one of these smaller totems with candles still burning around it. So here's what I think happened. I think that the cult of the Mothman suffered from a great schism. A schism that we don't really read about in any of the notes the cultists leave behind. The only reference we might get is in Jeff Lane's first holotape, where he kind of poo-pooed the idea of worshiping the Mothman because the Mothman was flesh and blood, a creature like every other human. He was much more interested in the interloper, the Watcher. I think the part of the cult that stayed true to the Mothman were crazy, sure, but they weren't violent. They all died on the day of the apocalypse because they were on the rooftops of Point Pleasant when the bombs dropped. I think that after the cult split, the darker, more violent element moved eastward into Appalachia, taking over churches that they found, converting them into places where they could worship the interloper. Unlike the church beneath the Mothman Museum, all of the other places have altars. An altar in the sunken church, an altar before the shrine where we find an impaled human skeleton at the church in the cemetery, even an altar in the mine whereupon we find the priestess's coffin. This part of the cult was all about human sacrifice, sacrificing blood to the interloper. What's even more fascinating is that we can make a connection between these cultists and other occult-like events that happen in other Fallout games. For example, remember the story of Jamie and the Dunwich Building from Fallout 3, a story which I covered in my video on Dunwich that you can watch here. he lost his father and followed his trail all the way to the Dunwich building. There he discovered that his dad had been turned into a ghoul. But while there, he began to change himself. Not just into a ghoul, but his personality also changed. He began to start chanting the name Alzared, Gieth, Gieth. After following a tunnel in the basement of the Dunwich building, we find the ghoul of Jamie raving madly before an obelisk. And out of the obelisk rises the figure of a woman. And surrounding this obelisk are roots, tendrils. What do we find in the final chamber of the Lucky Hole Mine in Fallout 76? We find a shrine made of roots and tendrils wrapped around an obelisk. This is a unique totem. This is the only one we find in Fallout 76, at least that I have found, that's made from an obelisk, like the one we found at the bottom of the Dunwich building in Fallout 3. Another connection is made during the Point Lookout DLC of Fallout 3. We find a ruined manor wherein lives Obadiah Blackhall, who sends us to a nearby ritual site to recover an ancient book called the Krivbekne. We find the ritual site by opening a hatch that leads to the cellar of a ruined building. At the back of the room, we find a tunnel leading into the earth, and just outside are totems made from gnarled tendrils and more human bones. At the very end of this cave, we find another altar, and behind this altar is a lectern with a human skull and the Krivbekne. What's interesting is that the Krivbekne was stolen from Obadiah Blackhall, stolen by the Point Lookout locals. These locals are called Swamp Folk. They've been mutated by the unique combination of radiation and other toxic waste in the nearby swamps, but like ghouls before them, their lack of intelligence makes them prone to being swooned by some sort of occult figure called Ugqualtoth. It is because of their reverence of Ugqualtoth that they stole the Krivbekne from Obadiah Blackhall. This sounds surprisingly similar to what we learned from Fallout 76. Appalachian locals are being drawn to the interloper. We read from the note on the priestess's coffin that the other cultists were drawn to the interloper through the first priestess of the wood. It is she who communicated with the interloper in a similar way that Jamie was drawn to presumably Ugqualtoth. In a similar way, Lorenzo Cabot was drawn to the deserts, where after much excavating, he uncovered his crown artifact, which he used to communicate with the ancients, which gave him telekinetic powers. In a similar way that a man was drawn to the Big Maw in Appalachia. If we head there ourselves, we find a note that he left just outside the Big Maw. I don't know why I came to the Big Maw. I'd never considered why we called it that. As far back as I can remember, that's just what it was called. I remember family picnics here and the older kids climbing down to swim in the summer. Now, though, there can be no question. I cannot say for certain which of the circumstances has caused it to open. I do know that I must go inside. Is it the smell? The sound? The warmth? Even as I write these last words, I am impatient to look back into the yawning abyss, the true Maw, the ancient namesake of Big Maw. If we go into the Big Maw, we see that the water has receded, but if we look under the water, we find the bones of a large creature. And sticking out of the water, we find two of these cultist totems. Similarly, back at Lucky Hole Mine in the final chamber, we not only find more of these prehistoric bones right next to the pile of cultist skeletons, but we find a spine and rib cage embedded in the earthen ceiling of the tunnel joined directly to this room, right next to the ceiling covered in antlers. This interloper, this Ugqualtoth, appears to have an insatiable craving for human blood. And if he can't find cultists to give him human sacrifices or to pour their own blood out for him, he'll use his mind to reach out to people and bring them to him. Was he possessing a great beast in the bowels of the Big Maw? A beast that died after the war? Why do we find so many huge animal skeletons in the same places that we find evidence of these cultists? And there's one more thing that connects all of these events. The faces. In the bowels of the Lucky Hole Mine, we found six faces. There was one metal face beneath the waterfall, behind the podium of the church, and then in the back room, where we found the interloper himself, we found five more faces overlooking him. As I speculated in that video, I don't believe these faces could have been brought down here. I don't believe they could have been forged here, especially since we don't find any forging equipment down here. I think our only explanation is that these faces were uncovered here. And it may be these faces which were the reason that the priestess chose Lucky Hole Mine as the place to summon the interloper. Faces that are similar to the face that we found in Dunwich Borers. You recall from Fallout 4, while exploring Dunwich Borers, we saw flashbacks of what went on here. And in one of the rear rooms, we discover a flashback of human sacrifices taking place before an altar. When we arrive, the altar has crumbled, leaving a huge waterlogged hole. If we dive into the waterlogged hole, we find the sacrificial blade, Krimviz Tooth, and at the very bottom, we find another metal face. Not stone, but metal. A forged metal face still buried in stone. It hasn't fully been excavated. Lucky Hole Mine is not the only place where we find these faces in Fallout 76. The Mire is well known for all of the weird vines that have taken over the place. These vines destroy buildings and sometimes lift them to the sky. One of these curiosities is a place called Tanagra Town. Here we see that the vines have lifted up the earth itself. They're not just lifting up a house, they've attached themselves to the rock beneath the houses and lift them high into the sky. We'll have to explore this place fully in a future video, but if we climb Tanagra Town, we eventually find a cave. If we clamber inside the cave, we find a number of gold veins, and at the very bottom, we find another metal face. It's still partially buried in the earth that had covered it, tangled in all sorts of roots and vines. This is more compelling evidence that these faces have been long buried in the earth, buried by some sentience, possibly by some ancient, long-dead civilization. I think all of this put together is evidence that the interloper is the same being or somehow related to the same being Oog Qualtoth that has been trying to use humans to achieve its own goals. We don't know its purpose, and we don't know if it's ultimately succeeded. After all, 200 years after the apocalypse, this Oog Qualtoth is still trying to reach out. To Jamie, who stumbles into the Dunwich building. To the swamp folk of Point Lookout. To Lorenzo Cabot, possibly his greatest achievement. Full control of, or influence over, a powerful, immortal, telekinetic human being. And to the sole survivor. It was he who was trying to communicate with us using flashbacks while we approached one of his faces in Dunwich Borers. But what was this Oog Qualtoth trying to do during the events of Fallout 76? Well, here's what I think went down. Before the bombs dropped, the Mothman had developed a cult following. This cult grew at Point Pleasant, until by the time the bombs dropped, it had several dozen followers and even a church in the basement of the Mothman Museum. But then Oog Qualtoth reached out to the High Priestess of the Mothman cult. He called to her, lured her to the Lucky Hole Mine. The priestess brought with her a few more converts from the Mothman cult. They intimidated the workers at the Lucky Hole Mine, forcing them to flee so they could take it over. They then did a little bit of tunneling until they found the six metal faces. During this excavation, they got thirsty, and so a spring sprung up in the mine. They attributed this to the firstborn of the wood, likely the very same Oog Qualtoth, likely the very same interloper. But then they needed food. The firstborn of the wood couldn't give them food, and so they sacrificed the priestess. I believe we can infer this from the note, his priestess. Blessed are you, first priestess of the wood. Through you we heard his voice. Through you we gained his strength. They were weak from thirst. A spring appeared. They were no longer thirsty. They were weak from hunger. They sacrificed the priestess and ate her to gain his strength. After all, this is the only coffin we find down here, within which are likely the priestess's bones, which means she had to die before all of the other members of the cult. Possibly from natural causes, sure, or maybe she was sacrificed. Sacrificed for her flesh to feed the other members of her cult. At some point, the interloper began to grow in the room with the five metal faces. Perhaps he was induced to grow by having the rest of the cultists sacrifice themselves. In the note, "His blood," we read, "The woods gave him life, gave him strength, but the blood gave him purpose. He gathered us, he taught us to share as he shared." So the interloper began to grow on his own. The woods gave him life, the woods gave him strength. The cultists didn't have to do anything about it, but to give him purpose, he needed blood. And then he tells them to share. He taught us to share as he shared. What did he share? Well, he shared the water. After all, that spring sprung up, giving water to all of the cultists, and that could only mean that the interloper gave it to them. So if he shared water, well, they can share their blood. Maybe they began injecting their own blood into the vines, or cutting themselves with these cultist blades, and the sickle maybe, and pouring their blood over them. I think the final note proves that we really are dealing with Ugh Qualtoth. In the final note, "His birth," we read, "He is the one who came before. The firstborn of the wood, blood wept from his branches, and he shared with all of his believers." If he came before, then he's an immortal or extremely long-lived being. Maybe an ancient being who helped create an ancient civilization. An ancient civilization that was on Earth long ago and placed some of their power in big metal masks underground. But how did these cultists die? Well, maybe they gave away so much of their blood that they died of blood loss. Possible. After all, in the final chamber amongst their skeletons, we do find a sickle, but we also find a bunch of specimen jars. Perhaps they were filling the jars with their blood and then pouring it over the interloper. But in the note, "His birth," it ends by saying, "Blood wept from his branches, and he shared with all his believers." I get the distinct impression that after the interloper had become strong enough, he produced his own sap, which the cultists called his blood. It oozed or wept from his branches, and he shared it with his believers. That is, they drank it. And here we find them dead. Could this have been some sort of poison? After the cultists had outlived their usefulness, did the interloper simply want them disposed of? But whatever happened to Jeff Lane? We get the impression that he arrived here at Lucky Hole Mine long after the priestess and the remnants of the Mothman cult. Like Jamie and the Swamp People and Lorenzo Cabot and the Soul Survivor, Jeff was drawn by a presence that communicated to him through signs and visions. He says that there are signs all around, that he's not the only one to hear the call. That means he arrived after the priestess and the rest of her cult. Though, he says, "Where they have failed, I will not, for it summons me alone in the end." Which means that by the time he arrived, they were all dead. "It summons me alone in the end" means that the priestess and her followers were dead at that time. And finally, Jeff says, "Let it be known in this world that the interloper has chosen Jeff Lane as the conduit of the unknowable." So the interloper wanted to use Jeff to communicate with and interact with the world, just like he did with Lorenzo Cabot hundreds of years ago. But we don't find Jeff's body. I suppose he could be any one of the numerous skeletons we find in Lucky Hole Mine. But as we just learned, the cultists were already dead when Jeff arrived. Did he just add his corpse to the pile? Or did the interloper need Jeff as a mold by which to take shape? After all, look at the interloper. He has legs. He has a torso. He has arms. They may be in the wrong place. They're growing out of his back, but he has them. And he has a head, though his head is just a mass of tentacles, but it clearly has a humanoid shape. By becoming a conduit of the unknowable, was Jeff Lane absorbed by the interloper? Is that how the priestess and the other cultists had failed? Did the interloper try feeding them his blood, but they all died? They all failed. But when Jeff arrived, he drank the interloper's blood, and instead of dying, he began to merge with the interloper. Is this what we see before us? The interloper taking human form? Will he eventually finally free himself from the earth? Will he eventually walk out into the wasteland? We don't know. But perhaps we'll find out in a future update. And that is the best explanation I can give for what the Interloper is, based on all the evidence we find in the game and all the connections we can make to the previous games. Bear in mind, this is all speculation. The true answers to this riddle could be completely different. But what do you think at my shot at answering this question? Let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. I publish many Fallout videos each and every week here on my channel, so if you don't want to miss my next episode, be sure to subscribe and to click that bell notification button. If you have and you still feel like you're not getting notifications, consider following me on Twitter at Oxhorn. I update Twitter manually with every new piece of content that I publish. I have a shirt shop with completely unique designs you can't find anywhere else. My designs come on shirts in a variety of men's, women's, and children's sizes, and in a wide array of colors. They come on other products as well, like smartphone cases, pillows, posters, mugs, stickers, prints, etc. So if interested, you can find a link to my shop in the description below, or you can click here. If you like what I do and you want to support me in a more personal way, consider becoming a patron on Patreon or a member here on YouTube. But more than anything, I'm just so glad you're here watching this video with me today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you soon with more brand new videos.